I went to a funeral home funeral recently, and it's the case there were little flyers that they give for you to take with you, and usually have a picture and the name of the person, the date of birth, and the date of death, and often they have a little saying or a poem. This little poem went like this. God saw she was getting tired, and a cure was not to be. So he put his arms around her and whispered, "Come to me." With tearful eyes, we watched her suffer and saw her fade away. Although we loved her dearly, we could not make her stay. A golden heart stopped beating, hard working hands to rest. God broke our hearts to prove to us he only takes the best. Are you kidding me? God broke our hearts to prove to us he takes only the best. How did we come up with this horrible stuff? But we've heard this and we've heard other things like, God won't give you more than you can handle. Or, everything has a purpose. And to all that I say, are you kidding me? Why do we come up with such pablum, such claptrap to try to deal with some of the difficult things of life? In today's gospel, they were dealing with the same kind of thing. I mean, are we really going to say everything has a purpose or God won't give you more than you can handle to the person whose relative was blown up by ISIS in Egypt? Or what about the person who dies of lung cancer that never smoked? Or what about the person whose child is born with a genetic defect? Or what about the parents or the siblings of a child that gets shot by gang violence? Is God really in charge of that? Are we going to come up with some sort of pattern statement to try to make sense of that? Instead of looking at what the gospel says, we had hoped, Cleopas said in today's gospel, we had hoped, and in the Greek that word is so strong and full of such rich meaning and we don't get it in the English, but what he was saying was all my hopes and all my dreams and everything that I had hoped for were in this Jesus of Nazareth, and I saw him do amazing things, and what in the heck happened? How did it end up that he ends up being arrested? He ends up being crucified. What went wrong? All my dreams are dashed. All my hopes are gone. What am I supposed to do now? I know that feeling. Do you know that feeling? I know that feeling almost a decade ago when I was underemployed and my children were on free and reduced lunch and I was living below the poverty level. And I was in a hole. Somebody had come up to me and God would said to me, you know, God will give you more than you can handle. I'd have smacked them in the face. What did I do to deserve this? And I get in this deep, dark hole. And I don't know, maybe it's a guy thing that I'm supposed to provide for my family. And so there I am struggling, doing whatever I can do, and it's not getting any better. When you get in that dark hole, you don't feel God anymore. You don't sense God anymore. You don't see any way out. And that's what Cleopas was feeling that day. His whole world had been turned upside down, and he didn't know where to turn. He didn't know what to do. And all he could do was just talk about it with his friend. And then Jesus comes along and they don't recognize him. And it's not till he takes the bread and breaks it and blesses it that they suddenly see the risen Jesus in front of them. And then they run all the way back to Jerusalem that Easter morning to tell everybody what they had experienced. So instead of all this pious claptrap, why don't we share the good news? In the midst of pain and suffering, where is God? Right there, in the midst of pain and suffering. We have a Savior whose throne is an instrument of torture. And that's where he reigns. He reigns in the midst of pain and darkness and suffering and want. And he shows up in bread. Every week he shows up in bread. He fills that bread with his presence so that we can be filled with his presence. I can tell you in my dark time, if it weren't for my family pushing me sometimes and my willingness just to show up and eat that sacred bread, if it weren't for my family and those Christian brothers and sisters who didn't let me stay alone in that dark hole, I would have never come out. The Christian response to suffering is just to be in it, to love in the midst of it, to walk alongside, not with pious answers, but with presence and with love. We eat this bread, which we call the body of Christ, so that we are the body of Christ wherever we go. We're called to be the people who renounce that evil, who fight against that evil, who push against that evil wherever we go. We're called to be the people who, in the midst of the darkness, don't try to give answers, but just are present with God's love and God's light. To allow the Holy Spirit to work through our presence, our ministry, being, to heal and to transform the darkness. Yes, there'll be a day. That day that comes, that day we all long for, when Christ comes again and the suffering and the darkness of this world will be destroyed forever. But in the meantime, you and I are the body of Christ. You and I, fed by his body, are his light. You and I are called to look for the people who are alone, to look for the people who are hurting, to not let our sisters and brothers stand in a hole, but to be with them, beside them, loving them. We say each week in our patron saint's gospel for mission, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness will never overcome it. Those of us who eat that bread are that light. If you take Christ's light into the darkness, you don't have to have an answer. You just have to be. Be the loving presence of Jesus, who from that suffering cross will take that suffering and transform it, will heal it, and will make all things new.